Please join me in our responsive call to worship. Let us praise God for the mighty deeds accomplished through Jesus Christ. Let us praise God for the mighty deeds accomplished through Jesus Christ. Let us praise God for the mighty deeds accomplished through Jesus Christ. Let us join with God's people everywhere and praise Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. You may be seated. It's indeed my privilege to welcome you to worship today here at River Road Church Baptist. We are glad that you are here. Whether you join us in person or via online, we celebrate the fact that you arose and came on this Sunday after Easter, even, to church, and of raising your voices in praise to God this Lord's Day. We celebrate your presence here. If you are a visitor among us, you're especially honored guest for us today, and we would invite you, as the Red Registry book is passed down the aisle, and everyone please sign, but we'd love some information about you if you are a visitor so that we might be able to contact you and provide you more information about our church in the week to come. We are glad that you are here. We also want to make a special effort to invite you to our reception, which immediately follows our worship service and our fellowship hall. You may go out this door and down the hall to the very end of it, and you'll find the fellowship hall there, or you can exit out the back and go to your left across the plaza into the front door of the fellowship hall there. But we'd love to meet and greet you there and extend our welcome in a more personal and warm way at the reception following worship. We have just a few announcements. For today, our Easter offering for CBF Global Missions continues, and we encourage you to prayerfully consider your gifts to that and important work that is being done by CBF field personnel throughout our world. The E. Carl Freeman Concert Series presents the Talis Scholars this coming Wednesday at 7:30. You will see there the link whereby you may purchase tickets. You can also call the church office if you need some help with that. These are the Talis Scholars, if you are not familiar with them. They will be warming up for their concert here with us on Wednesday night by performing a concert tonight at Carnegie Hall. So we're glad they'll be getting that practice in before they arrive here in Richmond to perform here in our sanctuary. And so we hope that you'll be present for that and make some time to come to that very important concert. It will be memorable. You will notice new member prospective orientation next Sunday at 4 o'clock in the assembly room. Thoughtful Faith Community this evening will be led by a group of our young adults as we begin to think about what it might ministry in the years to come as envisioned for and by young adults. And so it will be a very interesting conversation. Marnie and Beth have been involved in this effort that is being sponsored through Princeton Theological Seminary, and so you'll want to come this evening and be a part of that. If you've not made reservations, just come on, bring a sack supper or whatever you would like to do and join us. You will note as well that you can actually register for dinner next week on the 14th for Thoughtful Faith Community, in which our program will be the very popular youth dessert auction. So we know that you'll want to be here for that. Would you please continue in a spirit of worship as we go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God of new life, who would not be kept from offering us the same by any powers that be, not by religious establishment, not by the power of government, not by the betrayal of friends, not by stone, not by death, not by anything. What a wondrous thing to know that such love will even search us out, will find us wherever we are, at school, at work, at home, on a dusty road headed out of town, even in church. So in these moments, do open our eyes and ears, our minds and hearts. In this music, these prayers, the breaking even of this bread today, so that we might receive all the grace and truth and life you would have for us yet. We ask this in the name of the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our Old Testament lesson for today is Psalm 133. How very good and pleasant it is when kindred live together in unity. It is like the precious oil on the head, running down upon the beard, on the beard of Aaron, running down over the collar of his robes. It is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord ordained his blessing, life forevermore. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Pray with me. Gracious God, who showed us that life, eternal life, abundant life, is not to be found in holding on, but in letting go, not in gathering in, but in giving away, thank you for this opportunity to live out such life even now. Bless and utilize these gifts to make your love even more apparent to one and to all. Amen.
Thank you. I don't think there's a soul in this sanctuary that wants to trade places with me and try to preach after that. That was incredible, amen. Thank you, Victoria. For the last couple of years, Victoria has sung this beautiful solo cantata. Bob Gallagher has accompanied her on our magnificent organ. This solo cantata, The Way to Emmaus. We have done it on the Sunday after Easter or the second Sunday after Easter, depending on the calendar. This cantata presents the gospel lesson in King James language and was written by Jaromir Weinberger, a Czech composer who fled the Nazis in the 1930s and later became an American citizen. This piece, you may be aware, was made famous by the soprano Louise Natale, who performed it for some 27 or so years on Easter afternoon in the magnificent Gothic sanctuary of Riverside Church in New York City, accompanied by the now late organist Fred Swan. And Bob told me this morning that Louise sang it from that magnificent stone pulpit at Riverside. So, Victoria, if you ever want to sing it from here, you are most welcome. Friends, I shall not preach long this morning. I did that last week. But I will take just a moment to reflect on this striking biblical passage reflected in the music that we just heard. Luke here is describing the events of Easter evening. It's not a story about Jesus appearing to the disciples in the upper room with Thomas conspicuously absent. We are used to hearing that story the Sunday after Easter, and that is a wonderful story, but that's from John's gospel. And this is Luke. Know here in Luke, on Easter evening, two of the disciples are walking to the village of Emmaus, about 7 miles or so west of Jerusalem. And as they walk along that dusty road, a stranger walks beside them. But the way Luke tells this story, we, the readers, know that this traveling companion, this stranger, is Jesus. But the disciples walking along the road do not. How do they not know that it's Jesus? How do they not recognize it's Jesus? He's right there beside them. They spent their ministry with him. How can they not recognize him? And then Luke gives us a clue. He writes, quote, "They stood still, their faces full of sadness." Perhaps that's why they didn't recognize him. Anyone who has experienced deep grief knows all too well the brain fog, we might call it, that so often accompanies. Well, as they're walking along, Jesus, this stranger, asks them what they're discussing. They tell him all about the events of the last few days. They tell him about Jesus, about their hopes that he was the one, the Messiah, the one to deliver them. They tell him about those gruesome details his awful death. They talk about his burial and about the rumor that's been going around that he just might be alive. They say, well, it's getting late in the day. Would you like to stay for supper? They ask the stranger. And that's when it happens. In that instance, in that moment, that's when it happens. At the supper table, Luke tells us, Jesus takes the bread and blesses it and breaks it. In that moment, Luke says, their eyes were opened and they recognize him. Has that ever happened to you? Has that ever happened to you where in a moment, in an instant, you realized, my word, Jesus is right there beside me? Or maybe, and my experience is this happens more often, after the fact, you realize Jesus was with me all along, but I never recognized him. See, it happened to me once. It was probably 20 years ago, and I've probably told you about it before. I've probably told you all my stories before. I was in downtown Birmingham for a denominational meeting, and I was walking from my hotel to the convention center where the Cooperative Baptist Fellowship was having its annual gathering. I remember, not because of the encounter that I'm about to tell you about, but also because it was a beautiful day, one of those where there wasn't a cloud in the sky. I was walking along, and there in downtown, where you often find such persons, a homeless man approached and politely said, excuse me, sir, do you have a couple dollars? I haven't eaten, and I'd like to buy a sandwich. And I can be a skeptical person, I know. And in that moment, I thought, is this man really going to buy a sandwich? Or is he going to buy some booze or worse? I figured, you know, that's really not my call to make. I decided to help him out. And in that split second, I wondered what he might need beyond some food. I wondered whether he had some friends or some family or love in his life. I thought I had a few dollar bills on me, so I reached for my wallet. I got it out of my back pocket, and when I opened it up, I remembered that I had used those few dollar bills on a tip at breakfast that morning. The smallest currency I had in my wallet now was a $20 bill. That'd buy you a nice sandwich, wouldn't it? And 20 years ago, it would buy you a really nice sandwich. Here's the man in front of me. Here I am with my wallet open. I can't back out now. So I gave him the $20. And this was the Deep South, where being polite reigns. So he didn't look down at the money when I handed it over to him. He kept his eyes on mine. He thanked me and said, God bless you. And as he turned and walked away, I saw that he looked down to see how much money he had in his hand. He stopped walking. And he turned around and he said, "Hey, mister, can I buy you a sandwich too?" And in that moment, it happened. And I pray I never forget it. In that moment, Jesus was standing in front of me. In that moment, my eyes were opened and I recognized him. As best I understand it, dear friends, the truth is this. The risen Christ comes to us not only on Easter Sunday. The risen Christ comes to us the Sunday after. And the Sunday after that and all the days in between. The risen Christ comes to us on our happiest days and in our darkest struggles. He's there when we lie down in green pastures and beside the still waters, and when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Sometimes in the depths of grief, sometimes in the love of a sister or brother, sometimes it's in the breaking of bread, our eyes are open. And we recognize him. Amen. Sometimes it's in the depths of our grief. Sometimes it's in the love of our sisters and brothers. Sometimes it's in the breaking of bread. Our eyes are opened and we recognize him. That's the invitation to the table. The table that has been set before you by Christ himself. To take and eat. And hopefully recognize him. Let us pray together our prayer of thanksgiving. We praise you, O Christ, for in this meal you show us the power of your love for us. Following your call, as we love one another, may we glorify you with all that we are. Amen. On the night that our Lord was betrayed, he was sharing supper with his friends. He took the bread that was on the table and he gave thanks for it. And he broke it. And he gave it to his friends and he said, "This is my body given for you." And then he took the cup. And just as he had done with the bread, he gave God thanks for it. And he gave it to his friends and he said, "This is my blood
shed for you for the forgiveness of sin. As often as you eat this bread and drink of this cup, do so in remembrance of me.
body of Christ, the bread of heaven.
The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. Amen. Beloved church family, as you go forth, do so with renewed hope, trusting in the transforming and resurrecting love of God. For with God, all things are made new, especially you. Amen.